Hello, welcome to Panelogy number 20. The music you can hear in the background is Bisame Mucho, I don't know how to speak it out, played by one Barney Villain, a French sax player who was the inspiration for the main character in this comic book. And this protagonist is called Barney Too. This book is drawn by Jacques Delustal, and yeah, he is one of the two big Jacques, in my opinion, of the French comic world. The other Jacques, obviously, is Jacques Tardy, about whom I'd already spoken in Panelogy number 8. So, I just show you first the books that I've owned, and then I talk about some aspects of them. That's a stack of hardcovers. Very fine books, I must say, in general. Very well done by the German publisher Schreiber und Leser. This book is maybe the only one that's available in English. It was put out by Fantagraphics way back then. I can't believe it that this should be the only one that's available in English, but I did a quick research on with Google, and it was the only one that came up. Yeah, I can't believe it. Maybe you can tell me in the comments if there are English versions of it. But because this is the only one that you may get your fingers on in America or England, I will go on into a bit more detail later on. But yeah, here the other books by Schreiber und Leser. Tod eines Mörders. Focus. Death of a Murderer. Die Damen um Henry Cox. The Ladies Around Henry Cox. Die Brüder Adamov. The Brothers Adamov. Here's early stuff by him. Wege der Liebe. Oh, just quick look. Here you get, so I found this always interesting, some early takes of him. Story The Sandman. It's quite nice. And here you have a style full of hatching. He sort of experimented with this technique. Okay. Nachsaison, Postsaison. Yeah. And Deserted Hearts. Huh. comparing the two jugs, they have both a sense for crime noir, dramatic takes on stories, but Louis Stahl's stories are more simplified. Not simple, don't get me wrong, but while Jacques Tardy stories are more real detective stories where the whole mechanisms between crime, villains, and the police / detectives. The Louis Stahl books are always more like Greek drama reenacted in the France of the, let's say, 20s, 30s, until 50s. So, first half of the last century and the 60s as well. Characters collide as lonesome forces under the inevitable whims of fate. And if there's happiness to be found here, then it's the happiness, the idle happiness in a drug den or in the bed of a soon-to-be-dead lover. You can say that this sounds full of cliché, and yes, I must say that this judgment would be absolutely right. But Paringot, Monsieur Paringot, who writes most of the stories for Louis Stahl, has a sense for this often told stories, archetypes of stories, and maybe he thinks that these archetypes are worthy to be told again and again, and there must be a reason why some elements of stories are always come up in different combinations. So, but I think you have already the impression that I would like you to give that these books are all about the art. And Louis Stahl thinks of him not so much as a comic artist, but as an illustrator. The way he almost never uses speech bubbles and just put the words of Paringot down in the boxes below shows that approach. And it's the stories are some sort of sequence of paintings, and they are painted, and that's what makes them so important for me. Especially in times like ours, when in comic books there seem to be a competition going on sometimes, who can pack more action in one panel, more movement, more layers of stuff happening, more muscles drawn in anatomical correctness, and so on. And here, nothing is anatomical. No action happens. Nothing is really anatomically correct. Even if you look at this cover here, you can see that this head is actually too small if you compare it to this face, and they are twin brothers, and these two guys are twin brothers and should be the same size of their heads, but that's not important, absolutely not important. And but you have these panels where everything fits in an atmospheric way. Yeah, I don't want to show you, I can't show you the whole book, even though I want to. But maybe you have an impression. The comic books from Louis Tull are art books as well, I think. And the way you can look as a at a panel like this and go into the details how it is made, and you see the penciling and can figure out why he uses which color and so on. You get a sense for the magic that goes with drawing. The creating of something out of nothing. Just some lines, a bit color here and a bit color there. And you have a whole world with very simple means. With some colors and a pencil. Although this is a comic here that you are watching, is a sort of an exception. It's one of Louis Tull's later works where he uses some Photoshop in the post-production. It's done 2006. But here Photoshop is used very precise, and Louis Tull is not overdoing something. Like so many comic artists, sadly enough, do. Back to Bisei Mucho. That's one of his earlier stories, and from 1987, and here's no Photoshop at all. It's all hand painted. You see watercolor, and it is watercolor, not a Photoshop effect. And I think it's very important difference. I mean, I can enjoy some, in quotes, modern comic where one colorist uses Photoshop watercolor effects in a good sense. But maybe it's just me. I'm a guy who goes into exhibitions to look at some of my favorite paintings eye to eye, so to speak. to see how the artist has used his brush, how he drips the paint on the canvas and so on. And sometimes in a similar way I enjoy my comics when I look at this one here, how the color is brought onto the paper. Here he uses wet in wet aquarels and puts a little bit of white out to lighten the glasses of Barney here, and so on. And the tiles on the floor, just done with some strips of the brush. You can see how Louis Tal used his brush in a very fluid way to work out the atmosphere, and somehow in some panels you almost see the influence of the classical modern French painters. Think of the Impressionists and Fauvists, maybe Henri Matisse, or Raoul Dufy, and so on. I mean, these are not by far Impressionist or Fauvist paintings. That's a total other thing, but I doubt that these panels would have been possible if one hasn't seen an Impressionist painting and the way how the Impressionists and the Fauvists are dealing with light and color. And these experiences are all going into this book, or the books of this French guy, I think. Yeah, here, light is a very important point in his books. Yeah, story-wise, Barney here is part of a love triangle, and it's a very elemental story, and he's a very hollow guy, so to speak, who's more interested in his shoes. If this should be an homage to Monsieur Barney Villen, the sax player, seems not very flattering, but I think this should be biographic or so. This is just a literal figure, just a character in a comic book, and has nothing to do with the real Barney Villen. So, and here we have an homage to the very well-known pop artist David Hockney, who did some swimming pool paintings, Splash and A Bigger Splash and so on. Maybe I should stop rambling here and let you listen to Besame Mucho by Barney Villen, and flip through the rest of this book here. Hope you enjoy it. Thanks for listening and watching. Goodbye.